to others. Amen.
Let us join together now in the prayer for illumination. Let us pray. Eternal Spirit, you flow through the ages from the pages of Scripture, transforming hearts with your challenge, moving those who hear to new acts of faith, courage, and mission. Bless our hearts and minds in the reading of the Word, so that we might know your presence and power. Together to this reading from Luke's account of the Gospel, the 7th chapter, beginning with the 36th verse and reading through the 3rd verse of the 8th chapter. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she's a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, "I suppose the one for whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence, she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is forgiven loves little. Then he said to her, your sins are forgiven. But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Soon afterwards, he went on through cities and villages proclaiming and bringing the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, as well as some women who had been cured of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, and Joanna, the wife of Herod's steward Chuza, and Susanna, and many others, who provided for them out of their resources. This is the written word of God for all of God's people. Thanks be to God. When a rabbi such as Jesus was teaching in a Palestinian home, it was common for the doors to remain open so that anybody who might come could come and listen and hear. So you never knew who might show up. You might say that the church is like that. The doors are open to anybody who might come, and so you never know who might show up. Today, the host is Simon, a Pharisee. And the unexpected guest is a woman who is bad. When it comes to following the rules and doing the right thing, Simon is ahead. There's no getting around that. As much as we church folks have enjoyed taking pot shots at the Pharisees over the years, we haven't always been fair. Pharisees were good, they were. They were devoted to God and devoted to the law, devoted to the keeping of the law. Several years ago, I remember reading somewhere that the Pharisees were like the good people in your church who do all the work and sit in the pew every Sunday and pay the preacher to preach sermons against the Pharisees. Much as we like to preach and to hear that good people aren't as good as they appear and bad people aren't as bad as they seem, it's just not true. It's just not true. A good person is a good person and a bad person is a bad person. Good is good and bad is bad. And the woman in this story is bad. She is bad. The point of the story is not to convince anybody that she's not been as bad as they say. She has been. She has been bad. We're not sure what kind of bad she's been, though most of us could probably come up with an idea or two. And the good folks who made their way through those open doors to hear the likes of Jesus could tell us just what kind of bad she is, because they know. She's a sinner, and Simon knows it. And if Jesus were any kind of a prophet at all, he would know it too. He would. Funny thing is, he is enough of a prophet to know what Simon is thinking, and so he asks a question in the form of a story. He says, you've got two debtors, you've got one over here, and you have one over here. The one over here owes 500 days worth of wages. 500 days. And the one over here owes 50 days wages. 50. 550. And so neither one can pay, and the lender forgives both of their debts. Which one will love the lender more? Now that may not be the question we expect Jesus to ask when it comes with bad people. After all, isn't it our job as good religious church-going people to talk about how bad the bad people are? Isn't that what we're supposed to do? Isn't it our job to point out what's wrong with other people and why it's wrong and how wrong it is? And by the way, if you know that the answer is that it isn't our job to do those things, then you need to know there are a lot of people on the outside of the church who've gotten the impression that we think that it is our job to do those things. So it may be that we expect Jesus to ask a different question. You have two people. One's just a little bit bad, and the other one is really, really bad. Which one deserves to be punished more? Which one deserves a longer lecture? But Jesus doesn't do that. He doesn't. Instead, he goes, and he changes the language. He changes the words. And by changing the words, he changes the focus. Jesus, the prophet, the Messiah, the one sent in God's name, goes and changes the focus from what kind of person this is and who is wrong and what is wrong and how wrong it is and who deserves to be punished to forgiveness and relationship and love. Which one of them, he says, do you think will love? Now, it's easier, isn't it, to do the math the other way. It is. It's more bad behavior means a worse record and a worse reputation and more severe punishment or rejection. More good behavior equals a better record and a better reputation and more reward and inclusion. Simon probably believes that. And the woman most likely has heard it somewhere herself, though her behavior suggests that she's learned something about forgiveness and being forgiven that goes against the grain. So Jesus preaches a short sermon directly to Simon, and at the very least, indirectly to that woman. And that story has found its way to you and to me, and it's a story and a sermon about forgiveness. In fact, it assumes forgiveness, God's forgiveness to be exact. Jesus doesn't dissect forgiveness or define forgiveness or wax poetic or philosophical about forgiveness. He doesn't even tell you how forgiveness happens. He assumes the forgiveness of God. It just is. Okay? It just is. And that itself could be enough. After all, who in the world would just assume forgiveness without launching into a lecture about sin? But that's what Jesus does here. He assumes the forgiveness of God, going on about it even less than and he puts it in mathematical terms, maybe because that's what Simon does. Simon counts sins. He counts sins. And maybe that's what that woman has learned to do as well, to count her many sins over and over and over again. Even Jesus admits that they are many. They are many, he says. And Jesus doesn't say that the one who is the worst gets dealt the most severe punishment. He says that the one who is the worst loves the most. The math of forgiveness is a funny thing because you cannot contribute one thing to being forgiven. You can't. You cannot contribute a thing to being forgiven. You cannot get yourself forgiven. Cannot undo a wrong. You can't make up for the points you lost over here by adding up more good points over there. It doesn't work that way. You can try that, see how it goes. But ultimately, no matter how hard you try, you can't erase a wrong. You can't. It has to be forgiven. It just has to be forgiven. That's the only way. Forgiveness assumes a need that forgiveness can meet. To be forgiven assumes not your strength, but your weakness. As the 20th century German theologian Paul Tillich once said, forgiveness is unconditional, or it is not forgiveness at all. Forgiveness has the character of in spite of, but the righteous ones give it the character of because. And I think Tillich was right. I do. Those whose records are clean. People whose records are clean tend to get it right and get it right and get it right most of the time. Who are forgiven little. Why? Because there's just little to forgive. Want to make forgiveness a because. Because they're stuck on everything adding up. I'm forgiven because. And if you're forgiven, you're only forgiven because. And when they